Welcome back to the channel. Today I am discussing Letters from a Stoic by Seneca. I'm a pretty big fan of Stoicism. I've discussed probably Stoic ideas in some of my other book reviews if I haven't obviously reviewed Seneca before. But this is I've listened to some of these letters before. I've read parts of them. There's a couple hundred letters. So this Penguin edition, you can see it's not very thick. There's only a selection of about 50 in here. But it's come over time to represent a really good selection of letters that some of them tend to be repetitious. But the bookshop one that I've linked to below in the description for the video is the Dover Thrift Edition, which I think also follows some of this lead from the Penguin. If you're unfamiliar with Seneca, one of the wealthiest men in Rome at the time of his death, he was advisor to a couple emperors. And unfortunately, that also led to his death due to suspicions aroused in Nero. I think Stoicism gets a bad rap in the sense of when I hear someone talk about Stoicism that doesn't really know about Stoicism, they tend to characterize it as having no emotions. They'll say, "Oh, I'm very Stoic about such and such a situation." And what they mean is they're suppressing their emotions, or they have no emotions. And to an extent, I understand that framing. But I would argue the more important philosophical premise, one that I am 100% on board with, is the idea of not having emotion control you, but having you control emotion. And that applies to many, many things in life. Not having hunger control you, but you control hunger, no matter how many Snickers ads you watch. So can anyone really argue against that premise that it's better for us to control our emotions than have our emotions control us? Because if you do agree with the idea that you should control your emotions, then you subscribe to tenets of Stoicism. So Stoicism is not having no emotions or thinking that emotions are bad. It's simply not allowing emotions to have a primary place in our lives. And I think that that's worthy of imitation, worthy of emulation. But why read this? Well, there's a lot of good stuff in here, and I can't get into all of it, but I will give you the things that I agree with first and a few things that I disagree with. So, very early on in letter number two, this is something that I would become familiar with through hearing a Henry David Thoreau quote, which I think was referencing Pascal, which is that many problems in the world are caused by people being unable to sit in a room by themselves. Paraphrase. And here it is in letter two. Nothing, to my way of thinking, is a better proof of a well-ordered mind than a man's ability to stop just where he is and pass some time in his own company. No phone, no internet, just being there, being by yourself, being your own friend. I think that's extremely valuable. I don't think that can be said enough. In the same letter, it is not the man who has too little who is poor, but the one who hankers after more. A little further down, you ask, but it's still in the same letter, you ask what is the proper limit to a person's wealth? First, having what is essential, and second, having what is enough. So just within letter two, you can see two great nuggets of wisdom. And you might say, "Well, Stephen, yes, I know this, fine." But my point is, here it is, a couple thousand years ago, being said by someone who's very wealthy. Same thing that we would see in Meditations by Marcus Aurelius, written by an emperor, someone who not only has wealth but power. And these two messages are just as true for very wealthy, very powerful people as they should be for not wealthy, not powerful people. We should be able to pass some time in our own company and be pleased with it. And that it's not having too little that matters, but wanting too much. So I think those messages will resonate with a lot of people. I don't think you're likely to disagree with that. I'll pop forward to page 72 in the Penguin edition, and this is letter 27. Sorry, rather, it's letter 26. Letter 26. It is a very good thing to familiarize oneself with death. So this is a constant theme, not for the Stoics in general, but particularly for Seneca, that this consistently comes up. You're going to die, you're going to die, you're going to die. And I think that this is such an important message, particularly for our world in which we believe in transhumanism and we're going to Mars and we're never going to die. And I think part of the challenge of that kind of thinking is that it doesn't allow you to focus on the present. Thinking about death, I think, helps us be focused on the present. Past is gone, future isn't yet to come, and I'm going to die. It could happen tomorrow. In fact, he says, if God gives the tomorrow, be grateful for that. So we're never guaranteed tomorrow. So be present, live in the moment, and continue to familiarize yourself with death. He weaves this through all the letters. And as I say, I think that that's something that we could all do well to do more of. You can see there's a skull back there on top of an hourglass. I try to keep myself reminded of death whenever possible. And finally, here, this is in letter 77. When he's speaking about being cut off from life, suddenly potentially dying, you're leaving no duty undone, for there is no fixed number of duties laid down which you're supposed to complete. Which I have to say, for myself as someone who makes lists to get my tasks done and then crosses them off, it's consoling to read that because sometimes I think I act as if that's true. I have some fixed number of duties to complete before I die, and as long as I complete those duties, I'll be good. And that's not true. There's no fixed number of duties. God knows, I don't know, but that's the reality. Now, I said I would give you some things I agree with and then some things I disagree with. And I have to say, even as I tell you I disagree with, I'm very conscious of the fact that this is Seneca, and there's a couple thousand years of wisdom here that's been translated into numerous languages, and the man was wiser than I was. Wiser than I am, I would say. That's my default position, that people who have gone through more, who are older, they tend to be wiser than you. And I have that position with many of the mentors and the teachers in my life. However, I've come to realize, as probably in my late 30s, that as much as I agree with and respect my teachers and those who've come before me, especially those who are older, there comes times when I have to disagree with them for whatever reason. And what's interesting is I distrust myself because I am not them. They are older and they're wiser, and there's a reason I trust them. And so I immediately think, well, maybe I'm the idiot here. But I've come to realize, as I said, in my late 30s, that it's okay to disagree with people you respect deeply, even your intellectual mentors, and that your disagreement isn't just based in, it isn't only possibly based in ignorance. It could be based in a different approach that your mentor, your teacher, the person in older than you didn't consider. And even if they did, it's possible that they could be wrong. And I know it sounds strange that I'm trying to make all these excuses for it, but I'm just trying to contextualize the fact that when I see something I disagree with from an author that I respect, I simply try to work through the reasons why this author may not agree with my perspective. Not to say that I have the correct perspective either. It's just this is the way that I tend to see things. And one of the interesting, challenging letters that I read here was letter number 9, in which Seneca outlines his notion of friendship, which is much closer to what I would consider my top tier of friendship. I have often referred to this over the years as my 2 a.m. friendship. So a 2 a.m. friend, I can call anywhere, anytime, and the person's going to say hello, and I'm going to say something like, I need $10,000. I'll explain why later. Please, here's the bank instructions. And the person writes it down and sends the money. And maybe it's to bail me out of jail, maybe it's whatever it might be, but I don't expect all of my friends to either have this ability or to pick up the phone at 2 a.m. So I have let's say, a high tier of friendship, which there's only a handful of people in the world who I think qualify for that for me. Whereas Seneca, has as his base level of friendship my highest tier. He considers friendship to be of this caliber. What is my object in making a friend? To have someone to be able to die for, someone I may follow into exile, someone for whose life I may put myself up as security and pay the price as well. The thing you describe is not friendship, but a business deal, looking to the likely consequences with advantage as its goal. So I thought about this. So obviously there's a picture of of Velasquez's crucifixion in the background, and Christ said there is no greater love than for someone to lay down his life for a friend. And so implied in Christ's definition of friendship is this willingness to die. And then reading Seneca say to have someone to be able to die for, I think the challenge there is we may think, well, there are some friends I would not die for. So Seneca's arguing, well, then they're not really friends. And I think in our modern notion, particularly as Americans, you know, everyone's our buddy, everyone's our pal, that we think, oh, well, you know, are they not my friend? And I think we just have to confront ourselves with this possibility that it's okay that we may not necessarily want to die for somebody. That's not the first choice in any situation. But I do think it's helpful to go through the mental exercise of, would I die for so and so? Why or why not? And to recalibrate your understanding of someone in relation to you as a result of the answer to that question. I'm not willing yet to say that my friends are only the people that I want to die for, because as I say, even the people that I'd be willing to die for, it's a small number, but that doesn't mean I'm going to line up eagerly to do it. I'm still a weak human as anyone else is, and I would probably have trouble with that decision if it were ever to come to me. But as I say, I just take issue with Seneca having this extremely high bar for friendship, when I think the reality is most of us would consider that the highest level of friendship, and that our base level of friendship is nowhere near to this idea of following someone to exile, putting yourself up as security. So essentially, bailing somebody out, being their bail security. The other disagreement comes with his idea of travel. Now, I want to make sure I this is in letter. This is in letter 104. Now, here's what I agree with. If you really want to escape the things that harass you, what you're needing is not to be in a different place, but to be a different person. So I agree that you can't use travel to escape from your problems. However, in letter 104, later on, he says, but travel won't make a better or saner man of you. For this we must spend time in study and in the writings of wise men, like himself, to learn the truths that have emerged from their researches and carry on the search ourselves for the answers that have not yet been discovered. But I think the challenge is, for me, I have been made better by travel. From what I've had a chance to do, whether that's eating food that I've never tried before and learning something about myself, or talking with locals about their perspective on things, and learning something about myself and learning about them as well, that I have been made a better person by travel. I can only assume that, given the context of the same letter, Seneca is simply pushing back to this original idea that if you really want to escape the things that harass you, what you're needing is not to be in a different place, but to be a different person. So if that's the context that you read this in, that travel isn't going to help you get away from these problems that you're facing, yes, I agree. But if you look at the quote on its own, even just within this subparagraph, this paragraph, a few paragraphs on, I think it's problematic to say travel won't make a better or saner man of you without this without the qualifier in front. I do think travel offers tremendous opportunities for everybody to learn. The caveat, you have to be paying attention. You have to be wanting to do something other than go on the top 10 tour and tick all the boxes on your travel. And I've been, you know, hands up, I've been guilty of that really early on when I was younger and traveling. I have to go see and do all the things. But as time has gone on, I've simply been content to be present wherever I was and learn if that's possible. Eat, learn, talk to people, and take things in. And that's the best you can do in travel, rather than rushing to try to do all the things. Anyway, I could keep going on, as usual, with all these books for a long time talking about them, but I can strongly recommend this. I think also Tim Ferriss has a project in which all of the letters have been recorded on Audible. I don't know if they're worth recording. I think I bought the first volume, and they were pretty good. I don't know how well they work in the audio format, but I would certainly recommend this Penguin edition. As I say, the Dover edition I've left in the video description below. If you like this video, please hit the like button. If you'd like to see more, or you'd like to support the work, please hit the subscribe button. And if you'd like to contribute to more of these video reviews, there's a link to Patreon in the bottom. But in the meantime, enjoy your reading.